Good morning, Gospel Alliance Church. All week long, you know I've been sending out different videos. Well, today I decided, since it's Sunday morning, that we'll have a little longer one, a kind of a message from my living room of what God has for us as a church family, and as believers, maybe even beyond the Gospel Alliance family. Well, before we begin, how about we just pray? Lord, help us to understand what you are saying to us in the middle of a time that is unprecedented, uncertain, it's chaotic, it's everything that we don't want right now. But we come before you because we need you. And so we ask that you would speak this morning through the things that you've laid on my heart and the things that you've taught me. So we thank you, Lord, for your love for us and your presence with us through this time. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as you know, on Thursday night, the Pennsylvania governor shut down all non-essential businesses, people were laid off, projects were stopped, and frustrations obviously mounted. And then I noticed on Friday, my daughter, who's been visiting from Nashville, the mayor of Nashville posted on his Facebook page. He said this: "I'm pleased to announce that Metro Beer's permit board has adopted emergency regulations that will allow for the delivery and curbside service of beer. These regulations allow any permit holder with on-sale or on-off-sale permit to deliver their product to customers in commercially sealed containers." And I thought, okay, so I guess beer is considered an essential in Nashville, Tennessee. Toilet paper, I guess, is not. Maybe employment's not. And certainly being bored is not necessarily an essential to overcome. Well, you know, we have our kids at home. We have no church services now. You know, and as you probably have heard, we're going to try to do some drive-through prayer later on today at 10 o'clock to 12 noon today. Now, look, I confess that I complain a lot. I mean, all you need to do is ask Julie, and she'll tell you how much I complain. I'll complain about drivers. I'll complain about food. I'll complain about the interruptions of the poor service I might get. But one of the things I complain the most about, whether it's verbally or just it goes on inside of my head, is chaos. I don't like when things are chaotic. And boy, this time is completely chaotic. We don't know when this is going to end. We don't know how it's going to affect the economy. I don't even know what I'm doing today or tomorrow. I mean, things seem to change. And I finally was getting into a personal rhythm, enjoying moving into this area, enjoying getting to know all of you. And I was looking forward to our first Good Friday together, our first Easter together, and all that's probably going to be changed. So I had all these plans, I had all this excitement, these new ideas, getting new people involved, and poof, it's all gone. And so I complained to God. And I was reminded in Philippians chapter 4 what he says: I rejoice greatly in the Lord. And this is the Apostle Paul writing from prison. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. Now, I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. So here's Paul connecting with people from a distance because he's in prison. He's in quarantine, in a sense, and he can't connect with the people. And he finally hears from them that they are concerned for him, and that brings him joy. And he's talks about how he's learned to be content in all of these different situations. Positive Christians learn to be content. Now, unfortunately, myself, probably you, and a lot of other Christians, we get stuck in negativity. We get stuck in these cycles. You know, it's like we want heaven today, or we want the Garden of Eden right now. And so in the bad times that happens, you know, I would say, you know, all the churches I talk to and leaders and elders and pastors, sometimes they feel like they're manning the complaint department at Walmart. If it's not complaints about what's happening right now because of the virus and the lockdowns and the shutdowns that are taking place, Then we're complaining about our weight, or our money, or our health, or a husband, or wife, or kids, or parents, or youth pastor, or the kids' coach, or the government, or the music, or the last church we're in. We go on and on and on and on. And we have this like pattern of dissatisfaction and discontentment. And that's going to continue in our lives until we make the effort to learn to be content. I find it fascinating that Paul said, I have learned. And not something that just happened naturally. He didn't just like, oh, I'm content. He didn't just like pray, God, make me content. And he was content. No, he learned to be content. Learned. So as I'm reading this, I'm thinking, okay, here are some things that he would try to suggest to us. Number one, try rolling with the punches. Because look at the roller coaster that he describes himself. The time where he's in need, or he has a lot. He's hungry, well-fed. He's in want and in plenty. Sometimes the gifts from churches arrive for Paul. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes he knows where his next meal is coming. Sometimes he don't. And life for us is often like a yo-yo. We have health, we have sickness. We have extra care, and then we got car repairs. We have a good economy, then we have a bad economy. We have times of relaxation, then times where everything is crunching together. We have peace, conflict. Promotion, unemployment. Vacation, overtime. We have wins and losses. So we can either fight every time it's uncomfortable for us or bad for us and complain and moan, or we can go through the circumstances trusting that God is in control. Years ago, we took the whole family on a trip to Europe, a big family trip. It was an adventure, but I was concerned that my desire for order and for plans would end up causing conflicts in our family. Things wouldn't go the way that I wanted them to go, and I'd get upset, and then Julie would trivialize them, and then we would fight. And as a result, I asked my friends to pray for me that I would remember that the journey is just as important as the destination. The journey, not the destination, brings joy. Life is often a yo-yo, but it's the experiences along the way that we can interconnect with each other and with God. So flexibility is crucial. Now, I know some of you laugh at those people who are like, they need to have order and rigidity and routine and schedules, and you boast, oh, I'm flexible. But in reality, we're probably all not flexible when it comes to everything. As a matter of fact, some of you are probably not too flexible about how clean your house needs to be. Or maybe others of you, it's the use of your tools or your car or when unexpected expenses suddenly come in or suddenly one of your children gets sick or that surprise bill comes in the mail or when people don't live up to your expectations or school gets extended into the summer. See, basically, life is filled with uncertainties and sometimes chaos. And you and I need to learn to flow with the wave and not fight it. All of life's surprises should not affect my or your spiritual and emotional equilibrium. Let me tell you about Lee Gilbert. He had a great life, successful business, wonderful marriage, new home, wonderful adult children with 8 happy grandchildren. He served in his church, but suddenly Lou was diagnosed with cancer and he had to have 96-hour infusions of chemotherapy. It was a serious case. And after one treatment, he said, you know, I came into this hospital 5 days ago thinking I was going to receive chemo treatment. Well, that did happen. And now I'm leaving the hospital with something far more valuable than what I came in to receive. I'm leaving with such a feeling of gratitude to God for putting me in this place where he can be glorified through prayer, praise, music, singing, and hugs. I'm grateful that he gives me so many opportunities to receive and share his love. He went on to ask his wife, Darlene, if it was possible for someone to have malignant cancer and yield the happiness and yet feel the happiest he'd ever been in his life. That's possible. But what's the secret? Verse 12, I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. And then he says in verse 13, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. So he's not talking about that we can be superheroes and we can lift a car if we trust Jesus more. No, he's talking about that we can be content. The strength to be content is found in the power source of Jesus. So we need to plug into the power source. Not just go with the punches, but plug into the power source. The word content simply means a state of mind which is independent of all things, circumstances, and people. So in other words, it's not connected to them. It's not controlled by them. So the idea of contentment is the idea of separation, but the connection into something that's beyond those things. Now, some philosophers, Greek philosophers in Paul's days, would say that it was a matter of self-sufficiency, a mental willpower. And they would convince themselves that they didn't care about what happened. I don't care. And then they would shut off the emotions and become Stoics. They would say that the secret is, I can do all things through shutting off my feelings. Now, today people look elsewhere for the secret. I can do all things through drugs. I can do all things through education. I can do all things through money. I can do all things through my friends, through positive thinking. I can do all things because I know the right people. I can do all things through proper planning. I can do all things through my own strength, through my own coping mechanisms. But here Paul is saying is he's learning that only Jesus gives enough strength to handle life's ups and downs and to be content, to maintain emotional equilibrium and spiritual equilibrium separate from everything that's around us. Everything else just makes us feel good for a time, but it ends up being a charade. Doug McKnight, at 32 years old, was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. And over the next 16 years, it would cost him his career, his mobility, and eventually his life. He couldn't feed himself, he couldn't walk, and he struggled with all the emotions associated with that, you know, grief, depression, fear, failure. And despite losing all that he held dear, Doug learned contentment. And the evidence was on his prayer list, because when friends asked for prayer requests, and he gave them a list of 18 praises and 6 requests. His blessings outweighed his needs by 3-1. Years ago, friends of mine went to Burkina Faso in Africa on a mission trip, and they returned home astounded by the local Christians in that area. Here were people who had so little food, so little medicine, so little modern comforts, and their houses were like shacks. Their life expectancy were short. I mean, those who live in Pittsburgh park benches are better off. Yet here were men and women who were remarkably happy, joyous, content. I think the third secret that Paul was learning was to look for satisfaction in the right place. To look for satisfaction in the right place. The overarching theme of these last paragraphs, building up to what Paul says, is that he's finding joy and satisfaction and sense of purpose in Jesus. In verse 10, he began this whole little paragraph saying, I rejoice greatly in the Lord. And he says that because discontentment has its roots within our hearts. I think it feeds off that unbelief that's still there. And so a Christian, when I'm constantly complaining or feeling discontent, it's because I have a heart problem. At the core of our being, there is something looking for satisfaction. And it wants to be satisfied, and it's choosing something other than Jesus. And so our appetites go elsewhere. Something else is what's going to make me feel good. Food. Nope, I tried it. I get angry and didn't get what I wanted, and not to mention I get fat. Sex. Nope. Tried it. It put me in a selfish tug of war with my wife. Making people happy. Nope. Did that. There's always someone who isn't. Sports. Nope. My body rarely does what my mind imagines it can do. Entertainment. Nope. Fun for the moment. Always want more. Family. Nope. They're not always so loving. Ministry. No. The people don't always cooperate. Well, how about theology? I'm just going to invest myself in the Bible and learn that. No, because there's always an alternative view that sheds doubts on your own view. Well, at least you have your health. No, because one drunken driver can change that. A man went to his pastor in the midst of a financial collapse and said, I've lost everything. The pastor said, oh, I'm sorry to hear that you lost your faith. No, the man corrected him. I haven't lost my faith. Ah, the pastor said, well, then I'm sad to hear you lost your character.
I didn't say that. I still have my character.
I'm sorry to hear you lost your salvation.
Look, that's not what I said.
And then the minister observed, you have your faith, you have your character, and you have your salvation. Seems to me that you've lost none of the things that really matter. See, we can lose everything and still be content. Parents, can you lose your children and still be content? Husbands, can you lose your wives and still be content? Can you lose your job? Can you lose your health? Can you lose, I mean, just fill in the blank and still be content? Through Christ, we can do all things. And if not, then maybe we're putting too much stock in something other than Jesus. Because contentment doesn't just happen right away. As Paul said, I've learned. It takes time. It takes intentional effort. It's not going to just happen. There's no gift of contentment. Oh, give me the gift. You're not going to wake up one day and be more content and stop complaining. You know, at 27, I thought I was right about everything. And at 57, I know I'm not. And at 67, I'll have learned a lot more than I know today, but I'll still be learning. So you have to work at it. It is a skill to be learned through all of life's ups and downs. Each positive, each negative circumstance is a chance for us to learn to be content. The struggles we face are not obstacles. This time of shutdown, this time of inconvenience, this time of unemployment, this time of anxiety and what's going to happen next, this time of chaos is an opportunity for us to learn. To roll with the punches, to learn to plug into God's power, to learn to look for Him and to Him for lasting satisfaction. You know, one of the ways that I've done that over the years is by writing a gratitude list. And I have my journal back here. This is a place where I usually have my time in prayer. And in my journal, I usually write down a gratitude list. I think I'm going to do that today. Because positive Christians learn to be content. And I need to learn today, in the middle of all of this coronavirus, I need to learn to be grateful. How about you? Father, these are times where we need you more than else. Times where it seems things are changing every day. So Lord, we look to you for our contentment. We don't look to the government to make us happy. We don't look to our families. We look to you. Because it's only through Christ that we can experience the contentment of knowing that we are okay. So Lord, today, we lay our worries before you. We lay our anxieties before you. We lay our complaints before you. And we trust you for all that lies ahead. Amen. Gospel Alliance family, may God be with you today. Remind yourself how much he's right alongside of you. Because when he's at your right hand, you shall not be shaken. May God bless you this day, this week. Talk to you tomorrow. Bye-bye.